Okay, so first I would like to thank the organizers of the workshop for the invitation. And I'll discuss some statistical systems on random regular graphs. And my talk will be mainly based on the joint work with Vladimir Kozakov, Fyodor Levkovich Maslyuk, and Viktor Mishnikov. And the plan of my talk is as follows. So first I'll discuss the motivation of the study, and then I'll describe the derivation of the matrix model, which is relevant for the problem under consideration, present the solution to the matrix model, which can be expressed in terms of auxiliary elliptic curve, check the limit, and discuss some new double scaling limit, which a bit surprisingly involves the Lambert function. And we'll discuss the disk partition function. And probably at the end of my talk, I'll turn to another statistical model on the random regular graph if there will be some time. Okay, so first of all, I would like to describe, to explain what would the problem which I consider in continuum limit. So what we would like to consider is just the kind of two-dimensional gravity that is, it's necessary to sum over all two-dimensional matrix on the surface. But it's not the whole of the story, and we add the fermions which live on the surface, and they have non-trivial back reaction on the two-dimensional geometry. So actually we consider the combined system of two-dimensional gravity and the fermions living on the surface. There are several parameters in the model, and actually we will consider different limits for these parameters. First of all, there is a cosmological constant, which is just the parameter which counts the area of the two-dimensional surface, so generating parameter for the area. The second parameter is eta zero, is the parameter generating parameter for the counting of the length of the boundary. And if we consider this, the two-dimensional surface with the boundary. And finally, we have the additional parameter, which is most important for us. It is mass of the fermion. So we have anti-commuting variable, which not stand a bit with with second derivative kinetic action. And we would like to discuss the dependence of the mass of the fermions. This is the model which we have solved in some limit in discrete situation. So so when we consider this model, naively, we can integrate over the anti-commuting variables and get the determinant. And when we consider, and the power of determinant in general depends on the dimension of target space. Let me remind that we, in fact, we consider the mapping of two-dimensional surfaces into some target manifold in general of different dimension. And it turns out that there are well-known results when we have point. So we consider mapping of two-dimensional surface into the point. It is just the so-called pure gravity. We have no determinant at all. If we consider so-called D minus two target space, it's the theory of the directed polymers. Both of them are the critical theories. It is just fermionic determinant. And the very idea, which was invented long time ago, that instead of integration over the matrix on two-dimensional surface, let us perform the summation over the graphs. The idea was invented by Kozakov and David long time ago. And here we have we consider the random regular graph, so all degrees of the nodes are the same, and we will find the matrix model which substitutes the summation over the graphs, and we will solve this model in the leading approximation in the size of the matrices which correspond to the planar graphs. So in what follows, we will solve the problem in the final graphs. The discrete version, which we actually will work with, looks as follows. So we consider the partition function, which involves the accounting parameter for the genus G, the parameter lambda, which is the cosmological constant which counts the area. And we also have the determinant. Here, delta of G is just the graph determinant. And our aim is to evaluate this partition function. To sum over all random regular graphs. Actually, we consider the trivalent graphs, and looking at this formula, we could see and identify that when we consider zero mass, we just reduces to theory of direct polymers, and when m tends to infinity, we have the pure gravity. In what follows, we interpolate between two conformal theories. So we interpolate between, to some extent, dimension of target space zero and dimension of target space minus two. And actually, we will use heavily the quite important formula for the determinant of the characteristic polynomial for Laplace operator on the graph, which is generalization of old Kirchhoff formula. It was invented 50 years ago by Chelnokov and Kelmanis, and then rediscovered in physics 15 years later. From this formula, we see that mass of the fermion is generating parameter as well. But now it is generating parameter of the number of trees in the graph. So what is going on? We describe the determinant in terms of sum of the trees in the forest. We have the mass as the generating parameter, and V is just the number of the nodes in the corresponding trees. So we have this useful theorem, which provides, and using the dependence of the mass our partition function, we could evaluate the mean value of the trees in the corresponding graph. Our aim is to represent this partition function in terms of a matrix model. And its approach has a long history. And first of all, it was invented by Brizan, Isakson, Parisi, Zuber for general situation of integrating over matrices in terms of as a summation of graphs. So, and to two-dimensional gravity, it was it was applied by Kazakov, David. Later on, there are many different applications of this approach to two-dimensional gravity interacting with different conformal matter. So all examples concerns the interaction of two-dimensional gravity with conformal matter, and in what follows will in our study we consider not non-conformal generalization of all this stuff. And the most close issue and approach has been developed by Carrasco, Jacobson, Salyer, and Sakal almost 20 years ago, and generalized by in the papers. But there are some essential differences with our approach, since in that case they have four fermion interaction. How could we develop the matrix model? Actually, there are two ways on this road, and it turns out that both of them provide you the same answer. The first of all, approach concerns the some generalization of Parisi-Sorel streak. Parisi-Sorel streak has been invented in this approach, applied for this approach by David and Kostov Mikta sometimes ago. And the idea is as follows. So Parisi-Sorel is just the way to reduce the dimension of the target space. In fact, it was used to consider the reduction reduction of zero-dimensional target space to d minus two. The idea is just to use the anti-commutative fermions to reduce the dimension. But we would like to consider the interpolation between d minus point target space and d minus two target space, and we consider massive fermions. So we should consider a kind of generalization of Parisi-Sorel streak, and we add the following term in the Parisi-Sorel effective action for auxiliary supersymmetric field. Then, using the conventional integration in the Parisi-Sorel approach, we get first of all, we integrate over anti-commuting variable, and we obtained the following matrix integral. And upon the change of variables, we should remove the determinant, but instead we have non-trivial matrix action. So you see that here we have the usual Gaussian term, but the mass term is proportional to the solution to this quadratic equation. So we have unusual action in the matrix model. It is not polynomial action, and you could recognize the generating function for Catalan numbers here, but it turns out that it's true. And then the shape of the potential looks as follows. So we have a minima here, you have extremum, and we have additional wall. And so we have a bit unusual potential, but nevertheless, we could apply the standard way to handle with the matrix model, namely to consider large n limit, derive the corresponding integral equation, and solve it using the Hoppe-Wiener transform. The second way to get the effective potential in the matrix model is generalization of matrix 3 theorem for Kirchhoff. As I have mentioned, it was the the result for generalization of the Kirchhoff study. And here, as I have already mentioned, M square is the generating parameter for the number of trees. And now, instead of Parisi-Sorel streak, it's necessary to perform brute force combinatorics. And It turns out that the path, the part of this a bit heavy work has been done in this paper. And the idea is first to use the results for the unrooted trees, and this has been obtained via matrix forest theory in that paper, and then use some tricks to get the similar result for the rooted trees. So since there is the volume term here, the volume the origin of this volume here is just because we consider the rooted trees, that is why the volume form emerges. And it turns out that using this tricks from going from unrooted to rooted trees, we get the same result. So we have two very different ways which provide the same matrix model. That is why we could be sure that is correct. Now we consider so we consider the standard way to handle with the matrix model. We get the resolvent of the corresponding matrix, and it turns out it is expressed in terms of elliptic function, and the elliptic function correspond to we have one cut solution, but because of the square root we have additional cut from point C to infinity. So we have the resolvent of this model in terms of modeling of this elliptic function. And there are also some system of equations which provide the correct asymptotics of this function. In what follows, we consider only, and we have derived explicit solution to the matrix model in one cut approximation. What does it mean? So generically, you have two parameters, as I have mentioned. Two main parameters are cosmological constant and the mass of the fermion. And generically, it would desirable to have the solution in at all points of the two-dimensional plane. However, it turns out that the generic solution is very complicated, and we have succeeded in deriving solution at this dashed area when the one cut solution approximation is reasonable. When we consider the situation above this critical curve, there is no one cut solution because the corresponding density of the matrix eigenvalues is negative. So in general, instead of the genus one solution to the matrix model, it's necessary to consider genus two, at least genus two solution of matrix model. And this is the problem for the future. However, we have succeeded to solution here, and we have derived this critical point, this critical curve, which divide the two-dimensional plate into paths. And two limits of this critical curve correspond to the target space with minus two dimension. Central charge is equals to minus two, and this phase correspond to the direct polymers, and large M limit correspond to the so-called pure gravity, and the corresponding central charge in the conformal theory equals to two. And the most interesting question, of course, is dependence on M, which is completely new. And at all different points at this critical curve, we have a different average value of the trees in this graph. So there is the fragmentation of the whole graph in the sum number of trees. And the number of trees at different values of m is different. It can be shown that in this limit, we have the single tree. In this limit, we have infinite number at large n. You have infinite number of trees, and generically at these points on the critical curve, we have some finite number of trees. But in what follows, I'll show that there are some supple points here. And let me also emphasize that at all points on this critical curve, the typical graph size is very large. So to some extent, this is the way to characterize the criticality, and this is criticality in the standard way. There is non-analytic dependence of the partition function, and then it corresponds to phase transition of the second order. Okay, so how the solution, one cut solution looks like. So this is the expression for the plot for the spectral density. It is asymmetric because of non-trivial form of the matrix model potential. We couldn't expect the symmetric situation. And first, let us consider two different limits. First of all, we consider the large M limit. So we consider very massive fermions. According to the general rules of quantum field theory, when we consider the very heavy matter, it should decouple. So this fermion disappear, but there is some price for disappearance of the fermions. There is a renormalization of the parameters. In this case, we have only one parameter. That is cosmological constant, and indeed in this limit it gets renormalized. And a bit surprisingly, the formula for the renormalization of cosmological constant, beta is, I write the lambda in exponential form, then the renormalized cosmological constant looks like it you have a kind of asymptotic freedom. And our matrix model reproduces correctly the critical value of effective, this is the point of phase transition. Okay, so the opposite limit, when you consider the small masses, then using some simple formulas which relate the partition function of D minus two theory as derivative of partition function of massive theory at zero mass, we once again we also reproduce the correct critical exponent of the phase of Dirac polymers. In this case, we have the single tree. There is no fragmentation of the large graph into the three components. The next point, it turns out that there is some new interesting possibility. So we consider the small mass limit and the limit when the collision of branch points. So this is the point of the generation of elliptic curve, and the parameter p here is just the the distance between the critical point, and we consider small p limit. So we simultaneously consider the generation of the Riemann surface, two-dimensional Riemann surface, and small mass limit. In this limit, so we consider this ratio. This is the mass of the fermion. This is the size of the gap between the points. Both of them tends to zero, and but we consider the summation of all z-dependence variables, and it turns out that the answer is expressed in terms of Lambert function. So we consider, when we consider the following relation variable J and introduce T, which is rescaled Z here. And there is a kind of universal function emerges here. And you see that everything is expressed in terms of Lambert function. So it's clear that this Lambert function plays some exceptional role. And let me comment on this point. And it's a kind of a summation of non-perturbative phenomena. And all summation is can be performed inside of the radius of convergence. And this region is very close to small m part of the spectrum. So so this is the conventional relation for the Lambert function, and the radius of convergence is well known. So in some sense, we get the condition for applicability of this Lambert function. The area of the corresponding surface should be larger than this parameter. And let me comment that it's not too. Okay, so there are two other examples when the Lambert function emerges in the bit similar setting. First of all, let me mention that when we consider n equals 2 supersymmetric Young Mills, this is the Zeiber-Quitten solution of n equals 2 supplemented by coupling to gravity. And in this case, you have two parameters, and in front of traces of superfields. And so in the ultraviolet, we have two couplings. And then the question is how the renormalization group flow depends on this two coupling. And it turns out it was resolved by Nekrasov and Barshakov that this partition function allows the fermionic representation. And in this fermionic representation, you could immediately recognize that these times, these parameters T1 and T2 are just the coefficient in front of two generators of W algebra. W2 is just a conventional Virasoro generator, zero mode, and the second one is W3 generator. And the meaning of a Lambert function, it provides when we have no the second coupling, there is the solution which once again can be expressed in terms of arbitrary particular elliptic curve. This elliptic curve is degenerate when we consider T2 equals to zero. But when we switch on the second time variables, you get shifting the gap between two branching points emerges, and this gap between two branching points is proportional to the Lambert function. Very similar to this relation. This is the gap in between the branching point. It is proportional to the Lambert function and parameter here. So, there is also another way to recognize this the meaning of this Lambert function, why it provides the shifting of the moduli. Because it turns out that there is some relation between when you consider the topological strings, so-called for closed string, and also if they introduce some auxiliary brains, that is a kind of auxiliary Lagrangian manifold in some peculiar manner, it turns out that this inserted brain, the partition function of this inserted object, shifted the moduli of complex structures related to closed string. And this can be expressed in this following form. That is why the action on the Lagrangian manifold shifted the geometry. And here you see that Z is just the operator which corresponds to Lambert function. So it's not a big surprise that when we have the shifting of our solution due to mass of the fermion, we get a kind of Lambert function, which, by the way, is related to generating function for the Gorlitz numbers. Okay, so another solution which we have found is the solution to the case when we have boundary cosmological constant. That is why the two-dimensional surface with boundary. And what we have checked that we have reproduced correctly two known results for the boundary partition function for the pure gravity and for the Dirac polymer phase. And we generalize the previously known results for the finite M. And in the double scaling limit, which I have described a few minutes ago, the corresponding boundary partition function has very nice form. And this is new result. And also, there is also more complicated generating function for the boundary correlators. Once again, we have a new result, which can be expressed in terms of scaling variable Z. So in general, this result shows that the finite number of trees provides you very precise expression for the boundary partition function. Okay, so I have already mentioned that the result we have found perfectly agrees with the one known before. There is very peculiar form of the singular part of partition function. We have reproduced that one. Also, we have reproduced the partition function for direct polymer case. And as I have mentioned, we have a generalization of this story for the finite M case. Also, it can be shown that we could evaluate so-called ZZ instanton for our one-cut solution. It is the solution, the equation of equation in the matrix model, and it turns out that at the double scaling limit, which I have discussed before, it can be shown that the instanton action is not suppressed. So in general, it's necessary to sum up over this non-perturbative configuration. And pictorially, this is just the form for effective potential for the individual eigenvalue, and instanton correspond to transition from the flat point to the maximum of the potential. And so there are a lot of actually open question. We have this is just the starting point for some activity, and So in general, it's necessary to have generalization of this flow for different central charges. We have not succeeded yet in derivation of the solution in multi-cut matrix model. And also, there are some questions concerning, as I have shown, there are two solution to quadratic equation in Parisi surlaws, and we have used one of them, and it is still unclear what is the meaning of the second solution. So whether it's necessary to take into account, it's not quite clear. And and also there are some more or less standard question concerning the matrix model, which we have not touched yet. First of all, let us try to consider the standard double scaling limit when we try to sum up over the genus of surface. And in this case, we could expect some generalization of KDV and KP flows. And for instance, the indication of appearance of the Lambert function shows that we could expect the TODA hierarchy instead of and KP1. Okay, so I guess maybe 5 minutes. So because I have started later, so let me briefly comment on another statistical model on the same random regular graph. And now it has very different meaning. So in what follows, I consider the random regular graph is discretization of two-dimensional gravity. So I have tried to handle with two-dimensional gravity. But now there is approach in the solid state physics when you consider RRG as the model of the Hilbert space. So you have some complicated interacting system, and let us model the RRG by RRG the Hilbert space of this the system, and it turns out this approach is very fruitful and provides a new insights from for new phases. And in this situation, you investigate the and the so-called correlators this is the approach to Anderson localization. The question which hasn't been usually you don't ask this question in the context of matrix model, but here it's possible and reasonable to look at this stuff. And using some peculiar correlators, you can investigate the localization of that is why when you consider the motion of the degree of freedom on the graph, the question is whether it can be localized at this some part of the tree or not. This is non-standard localization in the Hilbert space. And to answer this question, it's possible to consider the so-called exponential random graph. This is a statistical ensemble. When we consider generating parameters for the different cycles, this is adjacency matrix of the graph, and just consider the different and the question: what will happen with the graph when we vary the generating parameters? And it turns out that there are interesting phase transition which are related to the my first part of my talk. And it turns out that the graph gets clusterized at some above some critical value of generating parameter. And for when you consider just triangles, three cycles, and the same happens when you consider four cycles. Now the structure of the graph, it turns out that it becomes a hypercube. So generic homogeneous graphs gets shifted and fragmented into the finite number of hypercubes. So this is very peculiar phase transition. And this is analog of the fragmentation of the graph into the trees, which I have discussed in the first part of my talk. So it's possible to consider level statistics, and it turns out that indeed in this case we have localization phenomena on this random regular graph. So my second conclusion, these models of exponential random graph are just the expansion of the determinant at large M, which I have discussed before. When we restrict ourselves by the first terms of the 1 over M expansion, you will find yourself just with these generating parameters. And so we have non-trivial interpolation between the single tree and the large number of trees. And this is actually the fragmentation of the graphs. If you consider the graph as a model of the Hilbert space, it's very useful for the different questions in which usually are investigated in the context of interactive many body system. So thank you for your attention.
Maybe one question.
I got a bit confused. In the first part, you have ribbon graphs, yeah? But when we have matrix models, yeah?
Yeah.
Ribbon graphs can choose. But when you consider this kind of model of Hilbert space, there's no ribbon structure of this, yeah?
Yeah, exactly. So when I have derived matrix model, generically, it's not you could consider the planar approximation. So the plan in the large n limit, you indeed consider the planarity in the ribbon type of the graphs. And in general, when you take out all 1 over n correction, you will get just the standard, the problem which I have considered at the second part of my talk. But indeed, the solution I have presented corresponds to the planar approximation, and the numerical results which I have shown in the second part of my talk correspond when we have no planarity at all. Your turn.
Yes, so you mentioned the Lambert function, which is often defined as a kind of fixed point equation, And then there is the tree generating function, which is sometimes called the Cayley function. And they are related in the following way. The tree function is minus Lambert of minus t. And I think that the definition that you use was, in fact, directly the tree function instead of the classical definition of the Lambert function. So I was not sure. And then it is bringing the question, are you getting it by some type of analytical computations? Or are you using the combinatorial meaning of this Lambert function, which are counting trees? And therefore, those trees are natural for the rest and so on.
This is a very good question. In principle, when you consider the summation of two-dimensional geometries, you have some contribution from multiple covers, and these multiple covers are closely related to the Gurwitz function. And and on the other hand, there is some nice result by Marina and with some collaborator who have shown that the Gurwitz function and the Lambert function are related in a very peculiar manner. And also it can be considered due to ELSV formula. You can relate the Hurwitz function in terms of peculiar integral of the moduli spaces of the complex structures. And so we expect that since we have summation of the moduli spaces in of the complex curve in via matrix model, and the Lambert function is related to Hurwitz, somehow we should relate this stuff. And this is a good open question, but we have no still complete understanding of this point.
Okay.
And thanks again.